Personal fall arrest systems need to be inspected prior to each use. A periodic inspection by a competent person is also required. Now, ANSI recommends these periodic inspections be done at least annually, but check your equipment owner's manual because their requirements are often more frequent. The best place to get inspection requirements is from the owner's manual for the equipment that you are using. You can also often find it on the tag or label. Whenever I showed up to a site, I'd head straight to the Connex and start going through the fall protection equipment, and I would just yank anything out of there that I didn't like. I ended up with a great collection of terrible fall protection equipment for that. We're going to use some of those examples to go through some sample inspections. So let's walk through a fall protection harness inspection. The first thing to look for on a fall protection harness is, does it have a label? Now, this is true across the board with all safety equipment. If it doesn't have a label, or if that label is not readable, you can't use it. Doesn't matter how good a condition the actual equipment is in, you have to have that label and it must be legible. Now in this case, the label's, it's pretty dirty, it's pretty worn, but it's there and it's readable. So let's check out the webbing on the harness. So the first thing you want to do is grab the webbing about 6 to 8 inches apart and kind of bend it. Now bending it will allow you to see the damage easier, but it'll also get you a feel for the actual structure of the webbing. And any brittleness that occurred from like sunlight exposure or chemical exposure will show up as you bend it and you'll really get a good feel for it. So bend it and pass the straps, all of the straps, all the way through your hands as you take a look at it. You wanna look for cuts, nicks, any type of discoloration, broken stitching, damaged webbing, all sorts of damage that could potentially happen. You can see here there's a cut in the side and a nick. There's some abrasion right here that's damaged the webbing. There's all sorts of stuff in here. This kind of looks a little bit like cigarette burns from the ash. Yeah, there's lots of damage in here. Now, chemical damage will often show up as stains or dark spots on the webbing. You can actually see that a lot right here. You can actually smell the damage too. The smell, it kind of, you get kind of an earthy type of kind of rotten smell that you can tell that it's been damaged. Sunlight will bleach the harness, bleach it white, or take the color away and also make it kind of brittle. Just from looking at the webbing of this harness out here, I really am not liking what I'm seeing. There's some serious discoloration, there's some damage, there's some cuts, nicks, all sorts of brittleness. So based on this webbing alone, this harness is dead to me. You can see why I pulled it out of service. So now let's inspect the hardware. Now the hardware, basically the metal components and anything that connects the metal components to the harness. So when you're dealing with metal, the first thing you want to check for is rust. Now you old graybeards out there, don't give me any lectures about protective oxide coatings. It's not protective, it's just rust. And if you see rust, you gotta get it out. And in this example, there's tons of rust right here inside the D-rings. Buckles are all rusted. Some very, very heavily rusted. If you find rust, that's it. You gotta get it out of service. Now check the hardware to make sure that it can move freely. We're gonna check the D-ring, check the buckles here. Now if you're using tongue buckles, you wanna make sure that the tongue buckles, that the straps can move through the tongue buckle freely and that the grommets aren't out of round or damaged in any way. So take a look at all the hardware components and just make sure they're in good condition and that there's no distortions on any of the components. So the last thing you wanna check on a harness is to see if that it's been involved in a fall. Now, most harnesses have some sort of impact indicators on there. A lot of them you'll find in the actual webbing. Here's an example. You can see that this part of the webbing has been folded over onto itself and then stitched closed. So if this part has been torn open, you can tell that this harness has been involved in a fall. Another one that's really common is on the back of the back D-ring, this plastic slotting here. Up here, this will get distorted or just break off altogether. And that's the sign that the equipment has been in a fall. And also just checking the actual hardware components themselves. If the back D-ring is stretched or out of round or any of the buckles have been bent or pulled out of shape, that's another example of a harness being impact loaded. If there's any sign at all that your harness has been involved in a fall, you have to remove it from service. So let's do some connector inspections. I've got something really exciting here for you guys. I call this one the Widowmaker. I've actually pulled this out of service several times. It is a twin lanyard, retractable lanyard system with rebar hooks. So just like any other piece of safety equipment, the first thing we're gonna do is check for the label. This has the label, it's right here on the back. You can see everything is legible. It's a little bit scratched up and dinged up. There's a label under here that's also scratched up, but it's still readable. So the labels are present. So connectors that extend and contract have mechanisms inside that need to be checked. There's two basic checks for checking the mechanisms. One is just to make sure that it functions properly and it pulls out nice and smooth as it's intended. So you can see it right here, you can pull it out, coming out nice and smooth. You want to pull out the entire length of the lanyard. So it comes all the way out. Oh, there's all sorts of dust and oof. I mean, yikes, dust coming out of there. And then it retracts nice and smooth. So let's go ahead and pull on the other one as well. So coming out nice and smooth, looking at the, oh, there is dust and grime coming out of this. That is not good. But pulling out the mechanism all the way out to the end, all the way back. Yeah, the mechanism was working fine as far as extension and retraction. So the next thing you need to check is the braking mechanism. This is the mechanism that stops the device when you fall. So you can just grab it up here nice and solid and give it a good pull. Oh, yikes, that did not stop at all. Okay, this is not working. Let's try the other one. Okay, yeah, see, sure tug on this one, and the braking mechanism happens on this one. Yeah, plunging to your death. So this one definitely does not pass the inspection. So now let's inspect the webbing. You can see here, it's old, it's a little bit worn, there's some dirt here. That kind of concerns me. Looks like there's some grime and dirt, maybe a little oil there. But you want to inspect the webbing, make sure there's no broken stitching, cuts, nicks, all that type of stuff. And then like we talked about, we need to pull this device all the way out and look at every single piece. Now, if you have a long self-retracting lifeline, so like a 20 or 30 footer, you're gonna need somebody to help pull this out with you so you guys can take a look the entire length of that. You wanna do that for both legs. And the webbing on this one, like I said, is a little bit dirty, but other than that, it's in pretty good condition. Doesn't concern me that much. So let's take a look at the hardware. Now, the first thing you wanna do with the hardware is make sure that it functions. Remember, it has to be double acting and self-locking. And then you want to take a look at it, make sure it's not out of round, there's not any damage, and check for rust. Now this one has the beginnings, it's a little weatherized, and it's got some beginning markings of rust. There's a good tip actually, because a lot of mechanisms that you can't really inspect the inside, but if you listen well, you can really get a feel for how it is on the inside. So rust on rust or rust on metal will often give you a squeaking sound instead of a good metallic, and if you pull it open, and let it go, you want to get a good metallic ring. Now, rust on a hardware can deaden that sound and make it kind of a dull thump instead of that big metallic ring. And that can be a sign that there's rust on there. And if you don't forget to inspect the carabiner as well. And if you look up here, you can see there's some rust on this one. And I can hear that little squeaking. It's not metallic, it's a squeak like a little field mouse. And that's telling me that there's been some rust on the inside of this connector. The connector works okay. But the connector itself is rusted. And the last thing we're going to check is the load impact indicators. We want to check to see if this piece of equipment has been involved in a fall. Now, retractable lanyards and retractable lifelines, their mechanism is on the inside, so that can be difficult to inspect, but they usually have some sort of indicators on the outside. In this case, there's little tags right here that say load indicators. And there's right here, there's a sewn piece of stitching right there. So if this is involved in a fall, this will tear open and then there'll be a warning sign on these tags right here telling that this has been involved in a fall. Now, these load indicators are not, don't say that this has been involved in a fall, but obviously something has happened to this mechanism. So it's another sign that it may be involved in a fall. And of course, the other ones that will tell you if it's been involved in a fall, if there's any type of thing out of round or distorted on the hardware that can tell you that this piece of equipment has been involved in a fall. So now we've got a different connector to check out. This is a 4-foot lanyard. Yay! I'm a big fan of the shorter lanyards, as we've talked about previously. So same thing applies. First thing you want to do when you're looking at there is make sure that the label is legible. So we've got the label up here. It says the capacity and all the inspection requirements. So yeah, we've got a label. We're good to go there. Once we've looked at the label, we want to check to make sure that the webbing is intact. Now, internal shock-absorbent lanyards, the ones that look like this bungee type that are internal, they're a little bit different from standard webbing because the webbing on here is not what takes the force of the fall. It's the material inside. So the webbing that you're really, really concerned about is up here at the top where it connects to the connector to make sure that this part is not torn or out of round. And then you want to give it a good inspection all the way through to make sure that there's no signs of damage, no chemical damage, no sunlight damage. And then look at all the stitches right here to make sure it's all good. And in this case, it looks pretty good. So we've looked at that, now we're gonna check out the hardware. Same thing, needs to be double acting, self-locking. The hardware on this one, I'm looking at it, it sounds metallic. It operates very smoothly, I'm not getting that grind from rust. It looks weather-beaten and old, but it doesn't actually look rusted. It just looks used. Same thing on this one. Yeah, I'm okay with the hardware on this one. And then the other thing we want to do is check to make sure that it's been impact loaded. Now, the standard rip ditch packs, the little packages of shock absorbers are different because those are easy to tell because they're just torn open and you know that they've been used. These are a little bit different, and there's two ways on the internal shock absorbers to decide to figure out if they've been impact loaded or not. The first one is simply at the top here. If you'll find it in the user manual, but it'll tell you. There'll be a little tag right here, and if it's been impact loaded, this thing will tear, and this little impact loading tab or danger tab will pull out telling you that this has been damaged. And then also, there's a note up here that says you can just measure this lanyard, and if it extends more than 2 inches past its original length of four feet, it's been involved in a fall and can't be used. So here we have a great piece of fall protection equipment, right? Webbing looks great, it looks brand new, all the stitching's in place, there's no chemical burns or damage. Mechanisms are double acting, self-locking, they're in good shape, but we do have a problem. There's no label on this thing, no label at all over the whole lanyard. Now, all for fall protection equipment has to be labeled. Now, since there's no label on this, this tells me this is probably not designed for fall protection. It's either for hoisting or some other type of climbing. So you can't use this without a label. And even if it did have a label, it's missing something else. Doesn't have a shock absorber. With no shock absorber, you can't use it for fall arrest. You could still use it for positioning or for fall restraint, but since there's no way to absorb the shock of a fall, you can't use it for fall arrest. So since this isn't a piece of fall protection equipment, we need to get rid of it.